What's up, y'all? It's me, Tasha C, and this particular review recap, I'll be reviewing Love and Hip Hop Atlanta. Oops, I guess I'm wanting to come back already. I meant to say Love and Hip Hop Hollywood, Season 1, Episode 11. Yeah, y'all, I'm probably going to put up the rest of the remaining episodes I recorded because I've been recorded actually since the Episode 1 review. And, you know, it's Thanksgiving. High winds are up here, so y'all who are do watch the My Real Housewife Atlanta reviews, I'm going to try to upload this and find some way just to watch it online or see if it records again because high winds took the off my DVR recordings, y'all. Oh well, but anyway, y'all, I plan on reviewing some more shows starting next month, you know. But anyway, y'all, let's get into it. Shout out to my YouTube fam, my older subscribers, and if you're not a subscriber, click that subscription button below and like, subscribe, share, and subscribe this video and stuff. Sorry, I'm just tired all over the place. Dad, but so he's 79 years young now, yesterday. Yeah, it's just been one of those weekends. I had an allergic reaction. I had to go to a hospital. I didn't know I had an allergic reaction too. You know, it's just been a crazy week, but heck, I am here. And the reason why I'm just rambling because really this episode, based on the previews, it seemed more entertaining in the previews than this particular episode. And the title of it should have been called, you know, Miscommunication and Is There Poison in It? Because somehow there had a lot of liquids and liquor or possible things that were given. Was the weapon of choice or, you know, a possible weapon of choice? And I'll get that to minute what that means. And of course, the miscommunication. Now, let's fast forward real quick. Morgan gets 5 seconds in there, and then Naya, you know, says the communication's always been a problem with her and Soulja Boy. And, you know, you've been with Soulja Boy when you still actually legalized a boy, and he's only but barely 23 years old on top of that age. I mean, there's a lot of things to be listed here. But she's trying to change somebody who's still in that state of mind and still, you know, who's to say it's changed, but it just won't be when you're around the purpose, and she's just trying to make us, I don't know. But she told him through text messages, I guess, like, that finally that she was pregnant and something about some communication, you know, thing that he don't care. So he blocked her off Instagram and shuts his wife down. She goes to Morgan's support. And she realized they probably weren't meant to have the baby, blah, blah, blah. Then we see another scene where Soulja Boy says, you know, he shuts down, something like that. And he has these obligations that, you know, to feel. It wasn't like he said he felt kind of offended. She said he didn't care or nothing like that. And something along those lines. So they talk, but basically still the thing is, I don't know if they broke up at the time or blah, blah, blah. And it was just like, you know, never gets off. He's like, you know, he has his obligations. He has still business to do, work to do. And she just feels like he doesn't put any time and effort and stuff and how she went to the situation. But Soulja feel he had a loss too. And that's pretty much how it kind of ends because I don't, you know, it is a sad situation, but it's just their storyline. Okay, let's get Nikki out the way. And the reason why I'm just bringing her up real quick is Tierra Mianora decides, and Lil Fizz me to damn near the end of the season, that she decides to have Nikki Bing introduce herself to Lil Fizz because of matchmaking. You know, she knew Lil Fizz because they got the same manager and shit. She brings Nikki, and Nikki's like, oh, he's cute, blah, 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 and, you know, and stuff. So they flirt and stuff, and see my Fizz is looking at her really from the neck down. He flirts with her, whatever. They go on this other date. He's talking about how, you know, can you date with Mandy Kiss? She's like, she'd love to. Well, everybody practice last kids now. So longer they mutual, they joke around about he bits about Monice a little bit because she says something about Florida Bobby Cultures of Baby Mama. He talks about, you know, I guess Monice in the hot dick situations and everything that she's selling. And she's basically like, well, you know, I'm a manager of a couple strip clubs. Maybe I give them some of the dances and see if they like or not, or we can coordinate. So they kiss at the end, and, you know, they say they both have a good time. And then I don't think they'll probably be in the same brought up again, unless they bring it up in the reunion stuff. It's her and Fizz still talking, which TMZ was saying the other day. I would just happen to look or something, Google something. And I could have sworn last week she was back with Molly Maul. He bought her another car. Is that, or maybe, I don't know. I could have sworn I'd seen something along those lines. So, yeah, let's edit that out the way. Now, this thing here with Lil Fizz and the Monique situation. Now, Amanda, apparently they are officially still broken up. Now, Monique, we seen one scene is basically singing at her cousin's house in the living room, and that's how she vents. And she goes again to kind of tell more details about the story of her life and how she's really not as bad as being depicted. And she's saying, you know, she had a record deal. No offense, y'all, but I could have sworn the story was repeated just in different words before. But she gives more details. It's like, okay, she's basically saying, like, Vince has only had their son for only since June. So I don't know when this shit was recorded. And, but at the same time, she was saying she was supposed to have a deal and fall through. She had to go live with her parents. But we did get some additional information. She has a roommate that had to be a platonic man who was a dickhead or something like that, she said, that she lives with. So she saved for a car. She's trying to stack and save to get her own place and work on take care of her son. But she wants to, in 5 years, tour, get an album, and spend more time where, I guess, where she could be cordial and they can co-parent with which Luke is for a son. And I guess the cousin was saying, like, you know, it's good for you to vent from singing and stuff like that. I didn't really get a chance to really pay attention to her singing too much. It just, I don't know, I think I was false with. No offense towards the show, I'm just saying. So, we get another scene. We might as well get the Fist thing out the way. Little Fist thing too. Now, she's been talking, you know, Fist has been not communicating with her. But apparently, we knew this shit was going to come up because she's been talking to the blogs about how basically saying this stuff where Fizz has been, you know, been making her his mini punching bag and shit, all this other stuff, and, you know, basically making her out to look like somebody she's not trying to, you know, imply and badmouth her as being a bad mom and she don't be around the kid or something along those lines. So when she came there, this was previous before even we see Hazel doing the same thing, or before with Tiara, which we'll get that in a little bit. And first thing, she gives him, it looks like some type of sweet tea or whatever, or tea, whatever, I don't know if it's Starbucks or some independent thing, or who's sponsoring them to give them drinks during this season of Love and Hip Hop. And she sits there and says, like, you know, the first thing Fizz says, you know, she was like, got a strong stuff. He's like, is that poison? Okay, that's a key word. Like I said, I was talking about how we got, you know, is that poison? And miscommunication should have been titled this damn show, this episode. So, he's basically, they start talking about this stuff where he's saying, like, she's basically, time, you know, she just lies every 2-3 seconds. She's basically lying over him. But I don't recall or remember whether or not she admitted that that wasn't true about him putting hands on her or whatever. But he, you know, because that wasn't brought up. But she's saying one thing, like, okay, whatever. You say one thing, I don't want to be around something. It's just unfortunately the same conversation we get every other episode when they're two in the room and they're talking, or their form of talking usually leads to an argument. And he was saying, basically, in a confessional, Fizz was, that, you know, when he, when Cameron was seven, six, 8 months old, when he's trying to say, like, some incident happened, I could have sworn he said that in the first episode, actually, about basically she's throwing the car seat through the damn window and all this crazy stuff, that he already had said that, and that's how he ended up getting so custody. But this particular episode, he kind of left that out. And, then he was talking about she didn't get joint custody until 2012, and then she just basically, his terms, just said effing, just had it where he's a primary giver of Cameron and she sees him when she sees him. I think I got that. So pretty much that's what they basically are about. Monisa's like, you know, I don't know, strawberries or pomegranates, something gonna come out. I don't know if she was trying to say this is like a little elf or whatever. I don't know what the hell they were talking about. But again, it was just unresolved, but still the whole issue's like, you know, you're not there, well, you don't let me see him, you're not there, you don't let me see him. Okay, next scene, y'all. I hope they can get along for the sake of their son. Or, you know, either, you know, this could be, you know, little fabricated. I don't know. Shout out to my cousin, YouTube cousin, I might be on here. I'm just saying, no, I was watching this review before I did this one. So, yeah. So, after that, let's get on to the Hazel-y / TT situation. And we have to save the Ray J thing for last, just because how the way it ended, you know, we gotta save it to the end. And it still pulls, I guess, continue on next week. And so, y'all, we got Hazel in the studio, and she's with her manager, Don, I think D-Dot or whatever his name is. And she had to know, like, you know, just because she ain't with her, she knows some dope producers and stuff that actually do want to work for her. She used to be a dope publicist. And then I'm thinking, like, even though I understand maybe her dream is to be rapping, does she still do publishing on the side to pay the bills? Because I don't think that rapping is Has anybody heard mixtape? Has she had mixtapes out? I'm not trying to be funny, y'all. I'm just saying is, if she's a rapper, and all these people you got are singers and rappers and shit on there, and they so called making music, why are their music is not listed as feature? You know, like a couple of some of the Love and Hip Hop's, like Hey Michelle and a couple of them, they do slide it in there. They're doing the song and get it promoted, featured. The artist featured. It's episode 11, and none of these artists yet had their shit featured. Have they, or has Tierra Marie has yet? I just noticed that. Again, I'm seeing the same problem with last season where I reviewed New York. Like, okay, you got all these artists here, and here's the title has to do with hip-hop or, you know, a gene, you know, I mean, hip-hop's really a culture, and yet we're not seeing these artists, if they're doing music at the time being the show's being filmed, why is the music not featured at the bottom? Okay, anyways, next. D-Dot's even talked to, you know, she's talking about the Young Bird, talking about the fake Masika thing, Young Bird, bitch, jazz, blah, blah, blah. Even D-Dot was like, the only relationship that you know, worry besides your business and getting your career together, the only person that you should mend that is worth saving is T.T., because T.T. was the only one to care about jazz, okay? So I guess Hazel thought about it, and she's finally decided to put on some goddamn white, and, you know, she actually looked decent, and ironically, T.T. was the one wearing black. And, again, Hazel brings some iced coffee, and the first thing that's brought up again, or before Lil' Fizz said it, is there's no poison. I don't know if Hazel said herself or the Tierra ass was a poison in it, but that seemed to be the key word for today. So, they're up here talking, and she basically was saying, admitted, like they did in the last episode, Hazel was starting to say to her, but she realized that Tierra did have her back. This young bitch ass had never cared about her and stuff like that and all this other stuff. And, you know, she was crying and everything else, and everything was going good and well. And then Hazel kind of fucked up, because she's basically like, okay, you have my back, but the only way you're going to have my back anymore if you don't do the song Young Bird. And Tierra was excuse me? The song is hot. I'm not doing this shit to be listened. It's all about business, basically like this. If you really get fucked with me, I wouldn't do the shit to you and stuff like that. Something about some movement, something like that. She took the rest of her iced coffee and got the fuck on. Because she realized, like, okay, Hazel, you were doing good to that point. You basically told me if, you know, like, basically I'm not supposed to work with Young Berg, okay? She should know by now that T.T.'s attentions are not the same as Masika, Miss, Masterpiece, whatever the heifer's name is at the moment. But that's how we're going. They were talking about it. Hazel was there and Tierra was just saying, I know I was trying to be there for you, but she understood why she'd been Masika. She even understood why she was just venting because of hurt. And, you know, even stuff that angle. But like I said, when Hazel dropped and told her basically, like, you know, I know it's an ultimatum and record scratch. Bitch, it's my cue to go. That's pretty much all that was. So, yeah. So, we don't know whether they're still not talking or not. Or will Hazel Lee apologize? Because she was starting to apologize and realize, like, you know, their friendship should be more than her finding some way. You know, because even though Xero Ree was, like, even let her know, like, you trying to say, like, I have something. I'm trying to be spiteful. But even though she knows the part with Young Berg doing this shit, realizing his attentions, it still is kind of like she's trying to make, you know, Tierra Marie, like, responsible for those actions, stuff like that. Like, basically, like, you're still okaying his behavior if you continue to make a song with him or work with him. You get what I'm saying? Or maybe that's just me. So, anyways, let's do the grand... Okay, we got one little scene with April and Mariana talking. And, you know, we still don't know the outcome. And we're taking baby steps with her and her mom issue. And, you know, Omar's like, you know, it's just going to have to take time. You just going to have no choice but wait. Are you willing to wait as far as the situation? Because we know April was like this. Because even Omar, I knew that April must have, like, shouted or did her... he said, April, woman, wonder, power, or whatever he said April did. But he even let her know, like, it's going to take time with Wusa. And also, another thing that need to be worked on is he wanted to know how April's mouth was pretty much doing and why it was not sitting here and basically not falling in his lap, apparently, because here he is basically like, well, you know, you've been a mom and, you know, it's been some time. And then she basically like, well, you know what? Why don't you? And he's basically like, wait, we gotta wait for 6 weeks. But I guess you could say is, you know, just because you can't penetrate me don't mean you still... I don't know why this part makes me laugh, but he just was looking like, and I'm like, girl, just wait till the all heals, whatever. Like, I guess she's like, well, if your mouth gotta stay closed with me, you just on your own, bro. You ain't getting no head from me, whatever, for this knee man. And then it ended the scene, okay? So I don't know if she ended up blowing his balloons or not. Jacob Ramona Shaw, y'all know it. So anyways, let's go to the Ray J thing. Ray J, I think one of the scenes is he decides to finally talk to Brandy. Brandy kind of and her mom were inspired somewhat. They decide to get, you know, the curly hairstyle kind of reminds her mom of what she just got through from, like, you know, being out of town, doing that, doing some work. And, you know, Reggie's basically saying, like, the thing with Morgan and all this other stuff. And it's basically, she's like, well, you got her on your business. That's supposed to be your assistant, right? And, you know, he's basically talking about what Tierra Marie said the other night and all this other stuff going on and, you know, contemplating. And Brandon just basically was like this. Nigga, basically, like, it's you, bruh. You don't want to want to send her all this. And ain't no sugarcoating and stuff like that. It's people to vibe you around, people you keep around. And she even kind of indirect hinting, you know. Ray J was thinking, like, maybe she don't like Princess neither or stuff like that. But I don't know. All I know, she was making sure to let him know that, bruh, you are the one that is causing these situations to happen. Is the company keep, is the way you act in these circumstances? And he's just like, okay, well, you know, I guess... He was somewhat, I think, starting to listen to her. I don't know if he said maybe you're right. But she was just giving some advice about, you know, be careful the company you keep. Be careful the company you do. One of those type of things. And so, you know, and like I said, the thing with the Morgan thing. And then I think she even brought up, is Morgan, he said he fired Morgan. She was like, well, when the heck was that? And he was like, she been fired for a minute. So it's basically like, you know, even when he was bringing about them saying stern stuff to each other, it's kind of like, bro, okay, still may have something to do with you because if all these people are complaining. I think that was along the lines of what she said, right? And so another scene that stood out, because I don't think I'm going through everything. Another scene that stood out was the last, kind of the last scene with Ray J, because Ray J was in this episode, but he really wasn't in this episode. But I really want to point out that particular thing. So he decides, you know, he grilling chicken with the George Foreman grill and all this stuff. Not to say nothing wrong with the boy George Foreman, that's a good cooker, okay? But what I'm saying is, he up here got champagne, ice glasses, whatever. He wants to work it out because him and Precious haven't really been talking, or some miscommunication and stuff like that. And he just wants to be able to talk to her. You know, especially ever since hearing some of this information about Morgan has put out there and possibly what she's put out there to Morgan. So we see Princess pull up and with the two dogs, whatever, coming out. She, you know, whatever, must have took them to the spa. He sits down and here she comes in. He's like, oh, this is all for me, blah, blah. So they sit down and he said, you know, we need to talk about a few things about, you know, what's been going on. And I guess the situation about, you know, he, you know, this situation Morgan was saying to Tierra Marie. And it got to the point when even he started saying, you know, Tierra Marie was right, though, about, I guess, the circumstances and maybe with her and all this other stuff. So, first it seemed okay, but you kind of knew it was turning on, because, you know, Princess kept swaying like this. We don't know how much liquor intake that she had, if she smoked some weed before she got on here, but she kind of was already in that mind zone, okay? So, in the end, when he basically, like, you know, the people you chose, you know, what you're saying. And then Prince was like, well, you know, you never should have had her around. Why she even had her son watching our dog? She ain't even paying a bitch and all this other stuff and everything and stuff like that. So, she was talking about him saying, like, you know, I vented to her thinking it was okay to vent to her. It was time that stuff has happened. So, it got to the point where Ray J, Ding, has got a light bulb supposedly in his head. And realizes it's meant for them to separate, okay? So by the time he realizes, like, maybe it's probably best for him to stay away from Princess for a while or whatever, whatever the case is, she takes the glass of wine, she sips a little more of the wine, whatever she had, throws a glass, drink one, and he's like, don't do that. And she took some Doritos, whatever the hell that she was throwing at him, and, you know, some food off the plate and started throwing it until he stood up. And then she, I don't know whether he got her up or she stood up her own self by the time someone, I think they both stand up. And he's like, no, don't do that. I think he was trying to get away from around her, I think. But she's trying to push him in the pool, y'all, you know, like this. And basically, he just bitch baptized or something. I don't mean to say like that, bitch, but it's like, bitch, you get a bath today. Because she just dropped completely. Now, I had to even rewind that part and just, boof. But like I said, y'all, Lord forgive me. I didn't mean to say baptized and the B word in the same sentence. I seriously did not, okay? But what I meant to say is he just was like, bitch, you getting clean for this evening. And that's pretty much it. Security did able to get it because they knew possibly it was going to escalate to something else. Ray J walking into the house and, that's pretty much it. She said she's basically going to fuck him up and stuff like that. And that's pretty much how the episode ends. And then you see the next clip, Tierra and Ray J seem like to go reconcile and all this other shit. And Hazel, blah, 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 gets in and confronts Masika again or whatever. And Hazel gets in contact with Nikki and all this other stuff. So, yeah, y'all. Sorry, this review was kind of mediocre, but in this episode, I'm kind of like this, just ready for the season to end. And what's going to take place in Reunion now, and then they already advertised Love & Hip Hop New York, and I think most likely I'll be reviewing that too. So, anyways, y'all have a pleasant night, pleasant weekend. And I definitely see y'all in the next video, and have a good weekend, or have a happy Thanksgiving if I don't get a chance to get the Real House 11 and up and up in time this week. But I will be trying to get it up there no later than the next couple days. So y'all take care. Bye.